often when we talk, the lodestar, if you will, is the ruling by the Supreme Court in 2013. I think it was 2013. And correct me if I'm wrong. To basically gut the Voting Rights Act by getting rid of the preclearance provision. And we saw, maybe it was 2011. I don't. You got to remind me of this. But it was within moments from that ruling, literally, you had Republican legislatures around the country changing their voting laws to essentially to disenfranchise voters in a way that they would have never been able to do if they had to ask the DOJ permission to change their voting laws because they were under that preclearance provision. Despite all of that, and you categorize this, I mean, you catalog this for years, we saw record turnout in this last election, and maybe in part because of COVID in some respects. Give me your sense of why that happened.
Sure. So let me just give you the chronology first. So the real war on voting that I've chronicled begins in 2011, when Republicans take back all of these key states in the 2010 election, and then in Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, North Carolina, Ohio, Florida, et cetera, they start passing new restrictions on voting. So that really lays the groundwork. Then in 2013, the Supreme Court weakens the Voting Rights Act and says that those states with the longest histories of discrimination no longer have to approve their voting changes with the federal government. So that allows discriminatory laws that were blocked under the Voting Rights Act, like in Texas, to go through. And it also encourages states like North Carolina that had not yet passed these new restrictions to put them through. So those are kind of the two pivotal moments, what happened after 2010, and then what happened after the Supreme Court gutted the Voting Rights Act in 2013. But I think in 2020, we saw a tremendous amount of organizing against voter suppression. We saw a tremendous amount of organizing to get people to vote, more than I'd ever seen before. And because of COVID, in most states, people had three different ways to vote. They could vote by mail, they could vote early in person, or they could vote on election day in person. And a lot of states didn't have all three of those options. A lot of states didn't have, for example, large amounts of mail voting, or they hadn't used early voting in big numbers before. So the fact that people had so many different ways to vote, and there was so much education mobilization going in to make sure that people actually did vote and their votes actually were counted, I think that's what led to record turnout in this election. Of course, that's what terrifies Republicans, because the whole purpose of these laws was to try to prevent this kind of turnout. And the fact that we saw that turnout, that Joe Biden won, that Democrats retook the Senate, has now led them to engage in a new effort to restrict voting rights that is very similar to what they engaged in after 2011, but in my view, even worse.
There's sort of like a quality of, well, in part an arms race, right? Because every time they come up with a new innovation to suppress votes, there is, or at least there was in this last cycle, a real strong pushback. And I think in part, you know, my sense is like, you know, the way that the Republicans in Wisconsin tried to diminish the vote in that primary vote where they insisted on it's completely safe to come and vote. And meanwhile, the guy's in a hazmat suit. And like, I think that really inspired people to get out there and figure out how we're going to vote in a way that we hadn't seen before. I also wonder if when we look at these voter ID laws from, you know, now 10 years, they've been, a lot of these have been instituted. Are we seeing, because younger, you know, we're just seeing a younger cohort, like there was a lot of older voters, particularly black voters, who could get disenfranchised by not having an ID because they're older, or, you know, a lot of times, like, they don't have the same state records. I mean, is there a generational shift, and there's because we've caught up with it, is that a less effective way of suppressing the vote than it was 10 years ago?
That's a good question. I mean, I think to your earlier point, Wisconsin was a major clarifying moment, the primary in April. The fact that Wisconsin was the only state that did not delay their primary because of COVID and basically thought, listen, COVID's going to keep all of these Democrats from the polls, so we're going to win this crucial state Supreme Court election, which is going to give us a 5-2 majority on the Wisconsin Supreme Court so we can do whatever we want for the next decade. Democrats saw that, they heard that, and they said, we are not going to let this happen. But it was also a template for future states to realize that this is the lengths that Republicans are going to go to try to suppress the vote. Everyone's going to see it this time. It's not going to happen, you know, under the rug like it happens in the past. Everyone's at home watching TV. Everyone is going to see these images. Everyone's going to understand what is happening here. And that led to the largest voter mobilization, largest voter education effort, I think it probably in American history, to really tell people step by step, this is how you're going to be able to vote in a pandemic. And there was more emphasis, not only in preparing people to vote, but making sure that their votes were actually counted than I had ever seen before. And I think, you know, when you have a law that's in place for a decade, people can start to figure out how to organize around it. So yeah, the voter ID laws are always going to be most burdensome the first time they're introduced. So it's going to have the biggest impact, for example, in Wisconsin in 2016, it had a much bigger impact than in 2020 because people weren't used to it and they didn't know what to do to get the ID. And there, it was harder for them to organize around it. That said, there are always people that slip through the cracks. When we talk about the record turnout, 66% turnout, I think is what it was in 2020, that still means that a third of the country didn't vote. And there may be a lot of different reasons why they didn't vote, but for a certain percentage of people, they didn't vote because they didn't have the right documentation. They didn't have the right idea. They didn't understand the rules and thought they weren't going to be able to participate or they actually couldn't participate. That includes, for example, like 770,000 people in Florida that should have gotten the right to vote back because they passed an initiative saying that people with past felony convictions could vote. Then the Florida legislature said, you can't vote if you owe past fines, fees, or restitution. So, I mean, Florida disenfranchised 700,000 people in the last election. That's a huge segment of people that were not able to participate in one of the most important swing states in the country. And we kind of all forgot about that after the election. And we talked about how Joe Biden underperformed with Latinos, which obviously was part of the story. But we didn't talk about how 700,000 people just couldn't vote in the first place.
Right. And one of the elements, two points, one that I've learned from you in the past, is that sometimes it's not even the actual provisions. It's the confusion around the provisions that it just, acts as what they call like a kludge, you know, and so it's like, it just provides a mental obstacle to voting. And people are just so confused by the whole thing. They're just like, I don't want to get caught into that. I also say in terms of that Wisconsin primary, a lot of folks I know in Wisconsin who work in this area, they were very thankful that Bernie Sanders maintained his staying in that primary race for Wisconsin because they knew that would drive turnout. And that really important in terms of winning those, particularly that Supreme Court race that was there.